Okay, so biodiversity conservation, it's a big topic. I will pick up some issues of current interest. We, of course, can also have differently focused conservation lecture for the tropics, because biodiversity is one focus. We can also look at climate change. We can look at the human population and effect on ecosystem services. And sometimes these different conservation aims have also contrasting methods, contrasting ways of how to get there. So, for instance, some of the measures of the climate change mitigation are directly harmful to efforts of biodiversity conservation, such as biofuels, as we will see, while at the same time, of course, climate change also, if severe enough, can impact biodiversity as such. So it's complicated. We had to make a choice, and so we will look at the biodiversity conservation. So looking at tropical forests, this is the global map of forest loss in last 20 years with differentiated loss, the most recent one in blue, and then the shades from red to yellow increasingly towards the history across the whole globe. So this is based on the satellite images. It's online map where you can zoom in great detail into any area. And you already see the global pattern where there is a serious lighted areas in southern Amazon. Then there is more distributed, dispersed deforestation in sub-Saharan Africa. And then there are big differences in Southeast Asia and the New Guinea area, where the Borneo and Sumatra islands are really light up, while New Guinea is still dark, which is, of course, a good thing. That means not a huge forest loss in last 20 years. We can have a look at details. So this is the situation in New Guinea, Borneo, Sumatra area, where you can also see that Java is dark, but this is a bit misleading because this is only the forest loss from the satellite era, which is last 20 years. Java had been deforested long time ago, so there is no further forest loss simply because there is more or less no forest left. The same goes for the Philippines. And so you have these old deforested areas. Now the deforestation frontier is at the Malay Peninsula, Sumatra, and Borneo. And then there is a serious danger, then Sulawesi and New Guinea will be next. This is the details of Africa and the neotropics, where you can see that the central Amazon around the Amazon River and the Rio Negro River is still fine. But there is a serious encroachment on the forest from the southern areas, from Cerrado ecosystems, which had been largely converted to agriculture, and now the frontier is moving north. This is a detail of the localized deforestation around the Manaus in the middle of the Amazon. So this is Rio Negro and this is the Amazon River. And you can see this is the black area is the Manaus city. And then there are individual roads and there is settlements and deforestation along these roads. These patterns are different depending on the cause of deforestation. So here another example from the Amazon where you can see the settlers creating agriculture fields and farms along the roads, while in the northwest Borneo, there are bigger patches which are commercially deforested areas for oil palm plantations and other agriculture. With this little black area with no deforestation being Brunei, which sells oil. And so that's one of the examples where something which is bad for climate change is actually excellent for the rainforest conservation. You can pay basically for rainforest conservation in oil. And then this is the Karkar Island off the coast of New Guinea, where these deforestation pattern is the result of Sweden agriculture, where individual family patches of the food gardens are distributed everywhere except the volcanic crater, because this is a volcanic active volcano island. So when we combine these different losses over the last 20 years, they are in red here with the humid tropical forest superimposed on them. So again, Sumatra, Borneo stands out as the most critical areas together with southern Amazon. The situation when seen in the longer term is even worse. This is a time series for Borneo when in 1950s was completely forested. And you can see that we are now basically down to the situation where only intact forests are in the middle of the island, where there is a high elevation forest. But in the lowlands, large parts were deforested, to large part also to industrial plantations in black here. And then the rest is selectively logged forest, which may or may not be bad depending on the intensity of logging, as we will see. The same goes for Sumatra, the same cycle. And overall, we can see in the development of the forested countries, we can see dynamics, predictable dynamics from high forest cover to rapidly falling forest cover with intense deforestation when there is a frontier logging and basically settlement on the land. And then there is a slowdown in the deforestation when the things settle a little bit into pattern of agriculture and forest. And finally, when the society first moves away from extensive farming into more capital intense production, industry, and then services, and then starts appreciating the value of the forest. So then the forest cover is increasing. And that's exactly where, for instance, Europe or generally the northern temperate zone is at, where forests are returning to the largely abundant landscape. While in the tropics, unfortunately, we are currently at these two middle stages most of the time, except for a few countries like Papua New Guinea still waiting for serious deforestation, which may or may not come, and then very few countries in that stage of returning forests. These are the global causes of deforestation and degradation of the forest. Shifting agriculture and forestry are on the same level. And then for the forest degradation, it's selective logging, a huge effect. And then in Africa, also fuel, wood, and charcoal production, which again shows that's highly inefficient production of burning materials, which with some capital investment could be easily replaced, but unfortunately it's continuing there. So these are the forest loss drivers across the globe. It's a bit simplified to the main types, but we can see commodity-driven deforestation, that's basically plantations, or pastures. So in South America, it's mostly pastures, mostly ranching. In Southeast Asia, it's mostly oil palm and rubber plantations. Africa is mostly shifting agriculture. And then we have forestry distributed in several areas. This is a more detailed map looking at individual commodities. So again, oil palm and then coffee, as well as rubber trees and other plantations in different areas. Brazil is an example of the current new pressures on tropical forest, which no longer involve logging for the sake of producing timber. That's actually a minority. Selective logging is the violet color, which is over the last 13 years shown here in Brazil. Quite small compared to conversion of the land to pastures and crops, which of course is bigger disaster because selective logging still maintains most of the local diversity, while converting to pastures, crops, plantations destroys the diversity. And then small scale Sweden agriculture is a minority in Brazil. In Papua New Guinea, there is old-fashioned forest loss structure, which is 50% of subsistence agriculture and 50% of selective logging. When we look at the importance of different agriculture products in a conversion of the land, this is expressed in the carbon emissions based for deforestation. So this is current currency different from biodiversity. It's easier to calculate, of course, and it has importance for climate change. So it's one way to evaluate the importance of the forest. If we deforest them, that means carbon emissions, and these are the causes of deforestation. With Brazil and the rest of Latin America, the cattle production is huge. So basically beef production, some of the accusation of McDonald's in America that it helps deforestation in Amazon definitely ring true. And then there are oilseed products, which will be soya in the South America, and then again huge in Indonesia and the rest of the Asia Pacific, oil palm as the main deforestation impact. While forestry is relatively minor, except for Indonesia and Asia Pacific, that has to do with the logging frontiers, which we have seen. There are some unexpected effects. For instance, the production of soya with its deforestation consequences hugely increased in South America. Why is that? Because the US farmers abandoned soya in favor of biofuel producing corn, because there were subsidies for ethanol, so that was more profitable. They switched to these crops, and that created a big market demand for soya from South America, which leads to deforestation. So that's another example where fight against climate change is directly harming the biodiversity in the Amazon, simply because it's using the wrong way to fight it. That means biofuels. Of course, the deforestation can be calculated locally in each country, but also you can think of the things you consume and how they contributed to deforestation. And so there are a few examples of that where I would emphasize, for instance, here Brazil. Brazil is really has a bad name in globally for its huge deforestation, and quite rightly so. But at the same time, Brazil is not causing deforestation indirectly in other parts of the world. Unlike, for instance, Germany, which of course does not cut down the rainforest directly, but the consumption leads to lots of trees from the Scandinavia, which is fine from the biodiversity viewpoint. There is no biodiversity in Scandinavia, everybody knows that. But then, of course, also around the tropics. The impact of China is both local and international, and Japan has a huge footprint globally on the deforestation, and of course, United States. Now, we have to say critically that we can be concerned about deforestation in the tropics, but actually in Europe, for instance, we have done the same thing in the Northern America as well, in US, not so much in Canada, where we have actually reduced the original forest cover to less than 20% in its minimum, which was a few centuries ago. And the big drop in the forest cover was between the Bronze and Iron Age, with producing charcoal. So this, of course, had very small impact on biodiversity, and you can even say that it increased biodiversity in Europe by diversifying the landscape and promoting some of the grassland ecosystems, which normally would be a minority, but different situation in the tropics, where such deforestation would be disastrous for biodiversity. So there have to be different standards, unfortunately, but this is also standards between relatively rich and poor countries, which adds to political complexity of fight against deforestation in the tropics. Now, as I said, logging is sort of receding into the background as the main cause of forest degradation, which in a way is actually more concerning, because the conversion into agriculture destroys all the biodiversity, while logging is not so bad if you do it for the first time. This is the first cut in the dipterocarp forest, which is actually heavy logging by the tropical standards, because dipterocarps have a lot of trees which are commercially viable. And so there is lots of logging, but then when the forest is left, it regenerates quickly and no species are typically lost. Why is that? Because in the high diversity of the tropical trees is handled poorly by markets. For marketing tree, you need to know a lot about the properties of the wood. And also you have to have assurances of a steady supply on the market once you start trading it. And so only a minority of trees are commercially viable, which in Southeast Asia, about 60% of production is attributed to 195 species. That's a lot, because these are most dipterocarps, which are uniformly suitable. But in Africa, half of the timber production is only from 7 tree species out of these hundreds which are there. In South America, it's 40% represented by 13 species. So that's why logging is mostly selective. The market could actually handle more species, but the problem is with the steadiness of supply for less common tree species. What is taken out of the forest, by one estimate, was only 8% of the entire damage. The main problem is how to get these logs away from the forest, where you destroy large percentage of trees, so that the cut down trees and destroyed trees together represent about half of all trees in the forest. This is also because when the cutting rainforest is not a simple business. When you do it, then lots of trees are connected with lianas, and so sometimes if you cut one tree, then a number of other trees are falling down. This is all very rough and very sort of basic business. You can of course do it much more less destructively to the forest with sliding trees away through certain paths rather than pulling them by bulldozer or even taking them out by helicopter, but that of course adds to the cost. And the problem is that logging industries in the tropics are some of the most primitive, most corrupt, most dangerous industries you can imagine. So when you look at logged forests, then they are not markedly less diverse than the initial forests. When you look at the per area basis, there is only slight decrease in number of species of plants in this case. And when you look at the basis of per individual, then the logged forests are even more diverse than unlogged, because you take out relatively common commercial trees, and so you are left with actually more diverse mix of the remaining trees. However, the logging industry tends to return to the forest for second and third cut in unsustainable rates. So this is an example from Borneo after the third cut, which basically completely destroys the forest, opens the canopy, and then the whole vegetation is taken over by vines and which are blocking succession. Now, when you look at the timber industry, this is the trading in the round logs. That's basically the most primitive way of exporting simply round trees. And you can see that in South America, nobody is doing that any longer. And more civilized countries like Europeans, for instance, don't import these round logs from the tropics. However, there are African countries and unfortunately Papua New Guinea, Solomon Islands, and then some of the Malaysian and Indonesian parts, which are all going to India. Then the timber is processed there, and of course then Europeans and others will happily buy some products from India. When we look at the basic processing of the trees, like plywood or sawn wood, then the trade is more diverse and includes also South America, goes to all kinds of countries, but again, a big part to China and also very heavily to Japan. Plywoods, Japan is a huge consumer of that. So it's, of course, it makes economic sense. for tropical countries to do some wood processing, but I would not overestimate the positive effects of that. Basically, no tropical country that got rich or more developed by cutting down rainforests. There is no relationship between the wealth of the country and how much rainforest they cut down. And this is example of the sawmill from Borneo. These are very dangerous jobs, very poorly paid. So in fact, this is Sabah, part of Malaysia, but all the workers there are illegal workers from Kalimantan, Indonesia, because Malaysians no longer want to do these poorly paid jobs. So I would not overestimate the social benefits of localizing this basic timber industry in tropical countries. Now, this is a bit similar to the deforestation rates. These are the rules for the landscape development. We start with natural ecosystems, mostly forest. Then there is a frontier clearings, subsistence agriculture, and then intensive agriculture. And that coincides with urban areas. And finally, people are getting, once the forests are gone, they start to value them. And so there are some protected areas finally. Of course, the pressure on the forests currently is not so much timber as the agriculture production. And so we need to look at how much of agricultural products we need. Of course, the human population is still increasing, although it's supposed to be peaking in the middle or second half of this century, from current 9 billion to about 12 billion people. So it's not a population disaster as was once feared. And I'm talking about this in detail in the first part of conservation lecture. But at the same time, we still need to increase the agriculture production. Another big factor is diets. This is how much land we need to satisfy diets from different countries. Yellow point is the global average. And so that requires already to take 50% of lands where you can grow something and convert them to agriculture. If we all ate the same way as in Ethiopia, we would need only 25%. And who knows Ethiopian cuisine, then maybe mm-hmm. It would be a good idea. However, if everybody in the world was taking the same diet as the Germans, then that means entire land which can be farmed would have to be farmed to satisfy that requirement. And for Australians, we would need more than one and a half planets to do that. So as the countries get wealthier, you can see the x-axis. There's a trajectory of when the countries get more wealthy, then they are getting increasingly demanding diet in terms of agricultural land. So that's another problem. And that can be a huge problem if China continues its movement. China is currently at the global average. Maybe India will not move so much with the tradition of the vegetarian diet, at least in the south, but there is this general movement. Although there are huge differences between countries of the same wealth. So for instance, you can see that Indonesia, contrasted to Mongolia, is an extreme difference, Japan to New Zealand as well. Although this case is a bit biased because there is also marine products which are clearly not involved here, and that's why Japan and Indonesia are so low. So when we look at the land use per gram of protein we get for different types of food, we see that the beef and mutton are completely terrible. And that's exactly the reason why New Zealand is one of the worst countries in this diet comparison, and Mongolia as well, of course. And pork is already 8 times better. And then we have poultry, even better, eggs, dairy. So animal proteins are the most conservative for the land if you use cheese and milk, not a bad proposition. And then of course you have vegetarian diet, which is even better. Why is that? Of course you have, there are physical loss. So you have energy loss during the transition between trophic levels. So we should not eat herbivores, and we should definitely not eat predators. What are the solutions to these problems? How we can conserve land from agriculture? Well, there are several propositions. We can convert global population to vegetarians. That would be actually the easiest way, but I don't know how feasible. There is some trend, but slow. The only area where they were successful is southern Indian states, but at least partly we can do that and should do that. Then we can develop plant-based meat replacements. There are several companies, Beyond Burger, which should be tasting the same as genuine beef burgers and be hugely more conservative, 93% less land than the beef burger. And then we can also grow meat tissues in cultures. That is still in the future, but there is a possibility. There has been actually at least one hamburger again produced, but it costs about $250,000. So there is still some way to go. And then of course, we can have a new green revolution. The current green revolution is ending. We need a genetic modification to restart it and increase the production. In the contrary, some of the environmentally popular ways are not helping or even making situation worse. Locally grown organic produce, what can be better? Well, locally grown is good in the temperate zones, in the rich countries, because the locally grown means it's not competing with high biodiversity. At the same time, there are good reasons, also environmental reasons, why we should not cut off tropical countries from the global market for agriculture. Because, as again I'm explaining in the first part of the lecture, the increased economic standards lead to slowing down the population growth. And so we have this important issue here as well. And the organic produce is actually competing with global biodiversity for space, because organically grown means that it's less productive. Some analysis show that organic crops only have 75% of yields, which could be there with standard agriculture. And so I would say it's a self-indulgent luxury of developed countries to have organically grown produce. We should not really give it much emphasis. So what is the realistic best case scenario for tropical rainforest landscapes? These are examples from Papua New Guinea, but they apply to other tropical countries as well. This is the remote New Guinea completely forested landscape. Of course, we want to preserve some of that, and hopefully we will in national parks, but realistically, it can't survive on the large parts of the tropical areas. This is actually fully protected, this is actually fully populated country. You just don't see the population impact there. And that's another problem, that people living in these countries are not against their forest. They see them as valuable assets, but they also want to have technological development and economic development there. That happened in the second type of country, which is just from sight of it, very, very pleasant to live in. It's fairly productive. It's a mosaic of agriculture fields. And then there is still reasonable biodiversity left. There are patches of the forest, a mosaic of grasslands and agriculture fields, settlements, and then planted casuarina trees, which are nitrogen fixing. This is from New Guinea, where the pollen records showed that this is at least 2000 years sustainable landscape. Now this is highly economically productive landscape with oil palm plantation, which is terrible to live in. Of course, we just can hope that, or should hope that, that tropical countries are not to large extent converted to such situation. And then lastly, this is a countryside which is covered by blocked succession stage with imperata grasslands, which burns every few years. So that countryside is non-productive economically and also very low in biodiversity, and nobody really wants to live there either. So this is sort of worst case scenario. Now we can also speculate a little bit where the tropical countries are going in the long term. We have already said that the population growth will most likely not continue endlessly. And so we might be looking at Europe and United States as sort of examples what will also happen later on in the tropics, because all these trends are followed by developing countries in the tropics. And so we can say that people will stop growing their population. They will increasingly move in the cities. Agriculture will get more productive and satisfy the nutritional needs. And therefore, the whole countryside will be more or less abundant, like happened in Europe, and will be growing back with forests. And also big animals will be returning, like they are doing in Europe, where all these animals are expanding either spontaneously into empty landscape or with conservation programs. So maybe if this optimistic scenario happens also in the tropics, maybe we are facing a critical period of time now where still for some time the fauna and flora will be under increasing pressure. And it's vital to really preserve what is there so that it can expand later when people get tired of living in the rural landscape, and they will all be happily surviving in the cities. This attraction of the cities is undeniable. We actually passed an important milestone in a few years ago when, for the first time in history, more than 50% of global population is living in cities, not in villages. And when you look at the population dynamics of urban and rural population, we can see that in the absolute terms, rural population is going down despite still very rapid global increase in population. So when we look at countries where more people live in urban than rural areas, we see that it's pretty much the entire world, except for most of the Africa, India, Southeast Asia. So for instance, in South America, that's already, Guyana is the only exception. When we extrapolate to 2050, that the trend is clear, then there will be only very few countries with majority rural population. If we manage to maintain the population density of Manhattan Island for the whole humanity, then all people will fit into New Zealand. So maybe New Zealanders would be not happy about it, but that means we will still need agriculture somewhere outside, but otherwise the entire world will be left to the wilderness. Now, speaking about conservation, we also have to consider oceans. There are actually very few long-term records of the diversity, but there are some fishing records which are shown here. Standardized number of species per standard longline fishing, and we can see big decline between 60s and 90s, which probably continues. International seas are the last sort of hunting, gathering arena for unregulated activities, which really should stop and cease and get under some regulation. But of course, it's politically very difficult. Example of the problem is the tuna fishery, which increased hugely from the 1950s to the current situation. That's about a tenfold increase. And that, of course, has a serious consequences for the tuna fish. And we have been looking at what is the proportion of unexploited biomass of the tuna fish for different lengths of the fish, and we can see that over the years from the red 50s, where fishing was really just minor nuisance to the fish, we can see that we are fishing 80% of full-size tuna in the current situation. And of course, tuna is one of the few predators which we regularly eat, so that has a huge consequence for the whole ecosystem. One relatively good news is that the increasing demand for seafood is being satisfied more and more by aquaculture. There are, of course, serious environmental problems with aquaculture, coastal ecosystems, mangroves, pollution, diseases of the fish and shellfish, but still it's better than unregulated fishing on in the high seas. And we can see that that unregulated fishing is basically steady for the last 25 years, and the whole increase in seafood is due to increased aquacultures. Now, when we go from the ecosystems to species and look at species extinction, it's a very serious concern, but at the same time, there are some still relatively good news. We can only speak about vertebrates, especially birds, which are extremely well known. Otherwise, we have no idea what's happening to plants and even, you know, let alone insects, for instance. So when we look at the extinction of birds, this is the graph for the last 400 years, and you can see that there is almost, so far there is almost no extinction on the continents, very very little actually, and the bulk of extinctions are concentrated on oceanic islands, where there was a speciation of locally endemic species. So we have New Zealand, Hawaii, Reunion, Mauritius, and Rodriguez. These are the main centers of extinction so far. When we look at the percentage of extinct species by 2010, then it's 2% or less for mammals, vertebrates at large, birds, and so that's still not too bad, although there are increasing number of endangered species, so there might be also extinction death. That means that lots of species are committed to extinction by their population sizes, but they are still there yet. Of course, this is the last 400 years, but when we look at the last 10,000 years, then actually the picture gets much more grim, because the first settlers on each continent, first what they did was to exterminate all large animals by hunting. So this is the extinction based on body size. So the black bars are extinct species, and you can see that most of the North American, all of the South American large species, almost all of Australian ones are gone. Only Africa escaped such a large scale extinction, and that's probably because the people were there for the long time, they evolved there, and so the local, they are no longer surprised for local fauna. There has been some controversy whether this extinction was really caused by people, because some of the people could not really stomach the idea that indigenous communities are actually contributing to extinction more than the entire industrial civilization, but it's actually the case. Because the extinction was moving in the step with humans moving to different continents, so it was faster in early settled areas, and for instance New Zealand, Madagascar came later than the continents. So when we look at the extinction estimates by researchers, then first I would say that the concerns about extinctions are very real and very important. At the same time, biologists are guilty of overestimating the extinction rates in their studies. This is a table of the studies coming from the 1780s, 80s and 90s, all by very well respected researchers. Some of them, like Lovejoy, you might know, Sim Berlofs, we already mentioned in previous lectures, Peter Raven, Myers, Wilson, E.O. Wilson. These are all well-known names, but they actually got the extinction rates wrong. This is the percentage of global loss of species per 10 years in their studies, and you can see that it's everywhere from 1 to 11%, and of course, that doesn't really match with the fact that there are 2% of extinct vertebrates for the last 400 years. So What went wrong? Well, all these studies are based on species accumulation curve. You remember that the number of species increases predictably with land area of the habitat. And so if we reduce the habitat, the logical thing would be to basically ride back on that curve and see when we reduce the area by 50%, what percentage of species will it support and what percentage will disappear. However, the paper by Hagliang He and Steve Hubble in 2011 pointed to a logical flaw in this. This is species accumulation curve. So that's basically species discovery curve. The species is added when it's first discovered. So for instance, here, when you go with the increasing area, then the first time the green circle is there, then it's added to the number of species. While species extinction curve is when the last individual of a given species will be encountered. And so you can't just go back and forth on the same curve for species extinction. And that was the reason for overestimation. Of course, we can also have partly this extinction death concept where species are still here, but the populations are so much reduced that it's a matter of time when random fluctuation of population or climate will get them truly extinct. Now, two more concepts relevant to conservation of biodiversity are hotspots and tropical wilderness areas. These were introduced by Mittermeier, and they are working tool for Conservation International. Each of these big name international conservation era organizations will sort of partition the globe into their own system of conservation priorities that makes them feel good and sometimes could be useful. Although biodiversity hotspots, they are showing that very little land area can support large percentage of known species. They are based again on plants and vertebrates, and the current hotspots as designed represent 0.5% of land area and include 20% of global diversity in terms of plants. Unfortunately, there is no algorithm how to define these biodiversity hotspots. If you optimize the land to maximize the number of species at the smallest available land, it depends on what is your minimum land area size. Of course, the smaller ones, the more fragmented you allow it, the better results you get, but also the less realistic one. So this is just completely arbitrary. There was no algorithm. And so you can come with even more efficient biodiversity hotspots if you want it. And that's the flaw of this concept, but it's good education to show small area can produce large number of species, although politically unrealistic. There is, for instance, Madagascar. You can't decide that we will conserve the all of Madagascar, not do anything there, and do all the other economic activities on the main continent. Probably people in Madagascar would not be happy about it. Wilderness area is a different concept, which is better defined. It has objective rules. It can be any area with more than 1 million hectares. It has to be large, 70% landscape intact. That's a bit open to discussion, what is intact landscape, but so be it. And then a human population below 5 people per square kilometer. When you define it like that, surprisingly, you can get 24 such areas which cover 44% of land area and only include 3% of human population. So that's interesting. But for the sake of biodiversity, there are only four of them important. One is Amazon, another is the Congo Basin, and then another is the savannas of Africa, and then the last one is the island of New Guinea. Now, when we go to the marine areas, then there, the biodiversity hotspots are located differently, while terrestrial biodiversity peaks typically in the Andes region of South America, then the marine biodiversity for many taxa, you can see fish, corals, snails, lobsters here, They all have maximum in what is called a coral triangle. That's an area between Malay Peninsula, including Sulawesi, Java, Sumatra, Borneo, and then going to the shores of Australia and New Guinea, and in the north to the Philippines. This is a very diverse area with lots of shallow seas, lots of dynamics between islands, promoting speciation. Now, of course, when we talk about the loss of habitats, then one big problem is fragmentation. That's what agriculture and other human activities do to the landscapes. And so for biologists, it makes sense to look at what's the effect of fragmentation, how species diversity changes with different size of the fragments. There is a famous Manaus fragmentation experiment where there was a lot of deforestation in Manaus area for the cattle pastures again. And so there was an agreement with the farmers to cut certain areas and leave the fragments in different sizes and replicate it for the study. That experiment provided some valuable data, although now there are two problems. First, the Manaus city is growing, so it's getting close to the experiment. And second, the farmers there are dependent economically on the subsidies of the government for the beef. Once the subsidies were removed by next government, then many of them abandoned this area and let basically the fragments to be connected by secondary forest again. But from the results, this is example where Manaus experiment is combined with the famous Kagamega forest in Kenya. And then this is looking at the fragment area and how long it takes to lose 50% of bird species from that area. And you can see that for 100 hectare area, it's about 10 years. For 10,000 hectare area, it's about 100 years. The fragmentation is important also because when you look at the tropical forest, then 50% of the land which is forested is less than 1 kilometer away from the forest edge. So, you know, there are only half of the land is in a big blocks which can be really, you know, really homogeneous forest. Recently, there was another attempt at fragmentation experiment, this time putting it into oil palm plantation matrix in Borneo, Sabah. This is again different sized fragments replicated, and this is the primary forest. All these was supposed to be deforested and planted with oil palm, but that never happened. The deforestation did happen, but not the oil palm planting. So another experiment which half failed. Now, another important conservation issue are alien plants and animals. We have already touched on that in previous lectures. This is a global summary of how the plants were moving between different geographic regions. So you can see the source of that region with this color band and where the plants go. And then also the part of when the given area is the recipient of these plants, again, color coded from different regions. So for instance, when we look at Europe, it's about half source and half recipient. The biggest flows are to the North America, not surprisingly, and also to different parts of Europe. So that's this loop. This scheme on the left is the randomized scheme, which would happen based on the relative importance of the local floras. So when you look there at Europe, then as you can expect, it should be much less important source based on its floristic diversity and a bigger recipient than it actually is. Lots of plants we discussed are from tropical Asia, are from South America. This is one of the biggest sources, but surprisingly, it's actually still less important in reality than you would expect based on its huge species diversity. When you look at these flows between geographic regions, then one conclusion is that there is a huge exchange. Almost everything goes to everywhere else. For instance, you know, you see tropical Asia, big source, which goes to virtually all other regions. The biggest flow is from temperate Asia to the North America. Some of the worst cases of invasive plants are freshwater ones. This is an example of water hyacinth, the South American plant, and this is Lake Victoria. Also in elsewhere in the tropics, which where it forms these carpets, which are causing problems not only for fishing and for boats, but also in the ecosystem. When all this biomass dies, then the decomposition will exhaust the oxygen in the water. So it's a big problem, and it's really hard to get rid of it. There are lots of these plants. They can grow from vegetatively from parts of the body. So mechanical removal is problematic and only temporary. You can't really spray it with herbicides very well. And so there is actually some successful examples of biological control. The water hyacinth is controlled by a small curculionid beetle, which is the herbivore coming from its native range. There has been several insects which were tested empirically, and this one won as the most efficient. So there were several projects where it was grown in hundreds of thousands and then spread into ecosystems, and then it sustained itself and reduced the water hyacinth. Then we have already mentioned Lattes niloticus. That's not strictly speaking invasive fish. It's a purposefully introduced one, economically successful, environmental disasters. And then Boiga irregularis, again causing really big problems for bird communities in Pacific Islands, originally coming from New Guinea. Also, pathogens can be a problem. Some of the hotspots of bird extinctions are the Hawaii Island, not only historically, but also currently. There has been news about one of the endangered drepanidid species recently. And one of the problems is introduced bird malaria, which was in two stages. First, there was accidentally introduced Culex mosquito, which spreads malaria, and then all the Plasmodium itself. And so some of the bird species which are vulnerable, they had to retreat to high elevation areas where the malaria is not present. This is an example of the Tanzania landscape, which is completely composed of alien species. In the forefront, you can see the plantation, and then background is eucalypt forest, and in the middle is a spontaneously spread invasive plant, Montanora hippicifolia. Of course, this is only going to get worse. This is the scheme of the air traffic before COVID epidemics. And of course, even more important is the shipping lanes and the shipping traffic. With the globalized world, there is really highly difficult to stop the spread of the invasive species, which actually means that, you know, at some islands, the number of species as such actually increased because the extinctions were more than compensated by introduced species. But of course, that's not exactly what we want. Now, I would mention malaria as an interesting case of affecting conservation, not only for Hawaiian birds, but also for people. Malaria, there are four strains, four species, Plasmodium falciparum, Vivax, malaria, and ovale, which are exclusively human. Although historically, we acquired them from apes, from chimpanzees, and for falciparum also gorillas. Falciparum is the most recent one, and that's also the most virulent, causing most of the mortality. So this is the infestation rate, the likelihood of children between 2 and 10 years of age being infected. And in some areas of Africa, it's basically 100%. And this is Plasmodium vivax, where the pattern is similar, except that you see a gap in Africa where there is almost no vivax, which is actually interesting because vivax originated there from the apes. And so why is it not there? Well, there is the Plasmodium has to get into erythrocytes. And so currently we are talking a lot about COVID virus and the spike proteins on it and how they are keys to the lock on the surface antigens of the cells, allowing them to get inside. The same works with receptors on Plasmodium and so-called Duffy antigens, which are defining Duffy blood group. There have been two of them, A and B, with different frequencies in different parts of the world, basically complementary. And then there was in Africa, there was a mutation which made the erythrocytes inaccessible to vivax Plasmodium, and that the Plasmodiums were not able to develop any countermeasures, and so they are excluded from Africa based on these mutations, which rapidly spread because it was highly beneficial mutation, rapidly spread throughout the population. So you can see that it's reaching 100% in the malaria areas of Africa. And that has important consequences on conservation because malaria is typically reducing human density and therefore impact on the ecosystems. Malaria is a really good example of human evolution under the mortality from this parasite. The Duffy antigen is only one mutation. There is the whole zoological garden of different mutations in erythrocytes, including alpha globin and beta globin mutations, which are part of the hemoglobin molecule, and other parts which always make the erythrocyte more difficult to access by the Plasmodium. And then the effects are different. Some of them protect against severe malaria. Some of them are even increasing chances of mild infection, but lower mortality when infection happens. That's this blue alpha globin mutation. Some are less harmful. Basically, these mutations, they all somehow damage the fine-tuned system of erythrocytes to carry oxygen. And so they are always bad for your fitness. And how bad, it depends on the mutation. And so there is always a fine balance between the benefits and the which depends on the malaria mortality in the place and the negative sides. That's also why in New Guinea, for instance, when there is severe malaria in the lowlands, but then also high mountains where malaria does not occur, then there are very strong changes in population incidence of these mutations. They are disappearing very fast to the highlands. So for instance, these alpha globin mutations are up to 90% in present in the lowlands and only 5% in the mountains. That means that it's harmful, so that when there is no malaria pressure, it disappears from population, but the benefits to protecting against malaria are so large than it maintains in the lowland populations. All this evolution against malaria is causing this kind of sort of reverted pattern of human populations in many tropical areas, including New Guinea. This is from New Guinea, where in the lowlands, there is population density below five people per kilometer, and it's only in the high elevations without malaria where population peaks. That actually has consequences on how the landscape looks like when we have this endless tropical forest in the lowland. And then once we come to the highland area, we get this much more cultivated landscape, which is not very different from what we know from the highlands in Europe. This is an example of the Sepik River watershed, where in the lowlands, they are completely forested, and the highlands with high population density, because the lack of malaria, there are many more grasslands and agriculture areas. And so the landscape looks like this and has always looked like that. This is the photo from the first contact where the landscape is pretty much the same, and it was shaped by stone tools at that time and remarkably similar to what we like in Europe. This effect of malaria on population density is because malaria is only transmitted by mosquitoes between humans. There is no reservoir animal, and that's why there can be a negative density dependent dynamics. When the population grows, then the transmission gets easier, more people get sick, more people die, and then population returns to low density again. So because of that, there can be a misconception that the lowland population, the lowland indigenous communities are somehow maintaining and protecting their forests. It's actually more likely that they can't do anything to these forests because of their low population density and until recently low technology. Even if you have only stone tools, once you are released from malaria at high elevations, you are no longer protecting your forests. You are doing to the landscape exactly what technologically better equipped Europeans did, and so you end up with this kind of landscape. So there can be a bit of a misconception about how intense conservationists are the indigenous communities. By the way, this is a bit of digression, but I think an interesting one. Malaria is a huge problem of global health and by and large neglected ones, because the patients are typically poor, and so there is not much profit to make on anti-malarials. There has been 10 years ago when the malaria death peaked, they were about 1 million people dying every year from malaria, which still was causing no big public outcry. Nowadays, we are down to about half of that figure. And there are two key developments. One was, ironically enough, the US-Vietnam War. Second was the Bill Gates Foundation. So for the US-Vietnam War, that, of course, took place in highly malarial areas. And so in 1967, Ho Chi Minh asked Mao to develop an anti-malarial drug for his Viet Cong troops. Surprisingly, Mao agreed and appointed a team led by Dr. Yu Youtu. Surprisingly, because Mao was anti-intellectual and anti-science, but in this case, he took the action. And at the same time, of course, the US government asked the Walter Reed Institute for anti-malarial for their troop. Their troops. And so in China, the approach was use 300 plant species known traditionally as effective against fever. And that included Artemisia annua. And from that, it was developed as Artemeter, which was amazingly efficient cure of all species of malaria. And while Walter Reed Institute took a more random approach, they tested 200,000 different compounds and found compound number 142,490 and developed Larian, which then company La Roche was marketing and producing. For Artemeter really changed the treatment of malaria. We have seen that in Papua New Guinea, where I witnessed the whole transformation of the medicine. I have cured maybe hundreds of malaria cases without actually having a medical degree, and that was because of this easy medication. And so quite deservedly, Dr. Tu Yu got the Nobel Prize in 2015. Interestingly, she shared it with other discovery, and that was the discovery of ivermectin. While the Larian was indeed efficient against malaria, but at the same time made people crazy, at least some of them really clinically crazy, and many others neurologically disturbed, at least to the degree of having very violent dreams. That was actually interesting, that there were very specific sort of you know, dismembering people, amputations, and so on, very bloody dreams. And that made people uncomfortable, especially in a often new environment in the tropics when they were traveling. And so after many years where company was sort of trying to minimize the importance of these cases, it was withdrawn from the market. And so that was one big effort. And then second was Bill Gates, who sponsored not only medicinal research, but also distribution of insecticide soaked malaria nets, which are very important tool to fight against malaria. And so we have now basically globally, we have managed to halve the mortality for malaria, especially in Africa, in the last 20 years, although there is still a way to go. Plasmodium is a eukaryotic animal, and so it's much more difficult to develop vaccine against it than against viruses or bacteria. But this year there was the first vaccine approved for use in Africa. It only reduces the chances of infection by 30%, but that means a lot of saved lives of especially children. Most of these people dying from malaria are children below the age of 10. So when we look at the impact of the other multicellular organisms on people and which one is the biggest killer, well, the accolade goes to mosquitoes, which killed three quarters of a million people, mostly by transmitting malaria, partly by transmitting dengue fever. Then comes humans. That's all the murders and wars and fights. So mosquitoes are actually worse. And then with a big gap are snakes killing people directly, dogs directly plus rabies. And then goes another transmission by tsetse fly and sleeping sickness. And then triatoma assassin bugs with Chagas disease in South America. And then the next one is freshwater snails with bilharziasis. So you may not think of freshwater snails as more dangerous to humans than lions, elephants, or sharks, but that's indeed the case. Then there are some human parasites, ascaris, roundworm, tapeworm, and then comes the usual suspects of crocodile, hypo, lions, elephants, wolves, and sharks with four people killed at the last spot. So now when it comes to conservation and how we organize it, we have to think that conservation costs money. So there is always a so-called opportunity cost of conservation. That's basically the profit you will get if you did something else with that area than conserve it. And you know, sometimes conservation can be profitable. You can charge entry fees to your reserve, but basically there are costs of conservation. This remote area of New Guinea on the left, that's an example where opportunity cost of conservation is pretty much zero, because the people living there, they have no access to roads, so they can't sell their produce. Nobody can go log their forest because there are no access roads, so they can't do anything with the forest other than have it. And so why not to conserve it? So that's an example of easy conservation, but also very unstable one, because once the landscape is fragmented and suddenly people living in conservation areas have access to alternatives such as logging, agriculture, and so on, they might very well change their mind. On the opposite scale of the spectrum is examples such as Hyde Park in London, where it has been costed that the lost opportunity of economic profit by developing that area are approximately 18.7 billion pounds. So that's one of the most expensive conservations imaginable. And of course, everything else is somewhere in between, but we have to always appreciate these costs when we are planning conservation. Also, sometimes we design biologically plausible and even intellectually clever global conservation strategies, which are completely unfeasible politically. Example, there has been a recent paper in Nature by Bill Lawrence, very respected conservationist, about global strategy for road building. So the team of researchers mapped the roads of the world, and then looked at the distribution of biodiversity and then potential for agricultural intensification. And then they designed the places which would most benefit from extra roads. That means the places where there are no roads. At the same time, they will not disturb much biodiversity and they will maximize the agricultural intensification. So connecting people to the agricultural markets. Okay, so far so good, but when you look, for instance, on the island of New Guinea, you will find out that based on this analysis, there should be no roads built in New Guinea, which would probably upset the local people because there the living standards are directly proportional to the distance from the road. If you are in a remote place, then you have no access to schools. You can build a school there in Papua New Guinea, for instance, you can build a school there, but no teacher will be there if it's too remote. They don't want to live there. You can grow your coffee, but then if you are lucky enough to have an airstrip and you can fly your coffee to the buyers, then you will lose half of the profit. On the other hand, you can sell food and other goods there, but if they have to be flown or carried on people's backs in the village, then they will be very expensive. So life is really much more difficult in remote places. And so even in the, this is a conservation area and remote village of Yavan, which has the airstrip and also a local school. And my colleague Martin Soukup had an anthropological research there where he asked children from the school to draw how they imagine the future of their village. And every single child drew a road and car there, although most of them have never seen a real car in their life. People simply desire this connection. The very isolationist remote Amazon tribes, so prominent in the media, where they don't want anything to have with the outside world, are really aberration. There are pretty much none such indigenous communities in entire New Guinea. And so the conservation has to somehow combine the principle of economic development and the preservation of the forest. Now, we also have the other perspective of the forest recently, and these are carbon emissions from deforestation. They are important. These are emissions from the forest clearing, forest degradation. When you plot them by latitude, you see that there is important tropical peak, especially in the degradation, which goes to Sweden agriculture, slash urban agriculture, and selective logging. At the same time, the carbon is not really the value we have in tropical forests. You know, we can capture carbon much more efficiently and better than in tropical forests. So valuing forest by carbon is somewhat dangerous because we can easily come to the conclusion that they are not the best tool for that. And so why to preserve them? Generally, functional arguments of ecosystem services to protect tropical forests are dangerous. We have seen the paper where there are 16,000 tree species in the Amazon, but only less than 300 species represent 50% of all trees. And that means that 50% of ecosystem services are basically conducted by 2% of entire biodiversity. Likewise, there are 300 endemic species of Drosophilas in Hawaii. Do we really need them there for ecosystem services? I really doubt that. There is a highly valuable species for conservation, the largest butterfly in the world. in Papua New Guinea, Queen Alexandra's birdwing butterfly. And again, there is no way how we can justify the conservation by ecosystem services. If that butterfly disappears and there is a danger of that because it has a very little geographic range and is under pressure from oil palm, then you know no ecosystem services will be affected. So we have to somehow, you know, these services are often a reason for payments for conservation, but we have to, whatever we do, we have to find some economic mechanisms, because when you consider indigenous people, or when you consider other stakeholders, conservation can't really be free of charge. So there are different investments, either direct, simply paying for conservation. That's partly what we do. We are running a conservation area in Wanang, lowland forest in New Guinea. And this is the example of the forest loss map I was talking about, but this time it's zoomed to local level. And so you can see the black hole there, which is the conservation area. So it really prevented loss from from the selective logging. And so it's one of the few conservations which have done that. But at the same time, it costs money, because these people, unlike from very remote places in New Guinea, they have a real choice. They can really visit a logging company and they will have loggers there very happily very soon. And so with the benefits, school projects, direct payment, employment for research, it costs about $7 per hectare per year to maintain this conservation area, which might sound acceptable, but this is 10,000 hectares. So you have to come somehow with $70,000 a year to maintain conservation. So as I mentioned, the red plus, which is a mechanism to paying for carbon in the forest, is actually welcome as one of the mechanisms which can help conservation. At the same time, principally, it's suspect, because it's not really directly related to the biggest asset of tropical forest, which is biodiversity. There is, as this graph shows, global analysis shows that there is no correlation between species richness of vegetation and carbon content. Also, we know that secondary forest, 6 years old, already has 1/3 of the biomass of the primary forest. So basically rotating secondary forests every year, as long as we manage to prevent the decomposition of the biomass, then will be much more efficient than maintaining the primary forest, which has some carbon content, but in terms of the dynamics, from 1 year to another, tends to be carbon neutral. So that means that it's no longer soaking extra carbon, it's just holding the carbon which is already there in the biomass. Okay, now who actually conserves tropical biodiversity? Well, the most visible are a few international conservation organizations, which also have a lot of stake in their public image, because they are fundraising from private donations. And it's the Nature Conservancy, which has almost the same budget, about $1 billion a year, as the Medicine Sans Frontier. And then comes WWF, Wildlife Conservation Society, and the Conservation International. These are the budgets for comparison with Czech brewery Budvar, and also the largest Czech NGO People in Need, Člověk v tísni in Czech. We can also ask, you know, this People in Need, that's a humanitarian, not conservational organization, and it's the only one from post-communist Europe which really reached global status and global budgets. We can ask, you know, where are such organization with international reach in biodiversity conservation from our region, which simply did not happen. But even these big conservation organizations, they are more controversial than you would see from their glossy advertisement campaigns. First, they are remarkably ineffectual in tropical countries. They are trying to do something in a different culture, you know, introducing a lot of assumptions from the developed countries. We have seen that in Papua New Guinea, for instance, where the long-term effect of these organizations is very little. I would argue that the only way how we can sustainably protect the tropical biodiversity is that it becomes interest of the local community and the local state. Basically, there has to be the emergence of the local middle class and educated elites, and that is the key for conservation, because these groups are driving conservation in the developed countries, and we can't import their influence to the tropical countries. So for that, the academic community, although very small, can be very influential. And again, for that, the research and conservation of local biodiversity has to go to that academia. So I would argue that the big organizations with millions of budgets, instead of direct conservation, they should really become educational and research organizations to build purposefully the research communities in tropical countries. To illustrate the current situation, these are ecological papers published about Papua New Guinea for the last 20 years, and those with dark colors are published without any Papua New Guineans being a co-author on the paper. So you can see that the entire research is driven by purely overseas research research activities, while when you look at Australia as a counterexample from developed country, you will see the opposite pattern, that a minority of papers is without an Australian. Of course, we don't want to have papers somehow forced to be locally involved, but we need organic growth of the local research communities, and then with the civil society accepting the idea of conservation. The societal, you know, conservation is mostly attended by biologists, but in fact, the main challenges are not biological. You know, it's rarely the case that we want to preserve a species and we need to examine it biologically to know how. There are examples like that, but more often the conservation is decided by the social aspects of the society and willingness to fund it, to prioritize it, and to execute the conservation programs. And there are also different traits of society which make it more or less easy. So this is the analysis looking at GDP per capita. So richer countries are investing more into conservation. Then other significant factors are general orderliness of the country, political stability, government effectiveness, rule of law. Otherwise, people have different priorities if this is not the case. But then there are interesting also effects of so-called power distance index, that is how easily people accept that not everybody has the same impact in the society, and then individualism. So, you know, how people feel needs to be conforming to the society. And different countries, there is some negative correlation between these two, and there are different attitudes in lots of Euro-American developed countries and as opposed to lots of tropical countries. And so these differences in society can actually cause some unexpected problems in misunderstanding of the conservation. And so this is also aspects we need to keep in mind. Okay, so this is really scratching only the surface of the whole conservation science, but I think we have to end there. Thank you.